Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's webinar, which is on assessment of weld in PE pipes, which is going to be presented by Mike Troughton. If you wish to ask any questions, then please could you use the Q&A box, and Mike will answer them at the end of his presentation. This webinar is being recorded, and the link, along with Mike's presentation, will be sent to everybody after the webinar in the next few days. And over to you, Mike.
Okay, thanks very much.
My name is Mike Troughton, and I am a technology fellow for plastics at TWI. I joined the company in 1993, and for the past 29 years, I've been carrying out research into the welding of polyethylene pipes and the assessment of the welded joints. So for the next 45 minutes or so, I will be describing some of that work that that I've been carrying out. So if we look at the integrity of welded PE pipe joints, they depend on a number of factors. So the first one is the quality of the pipes and fittings used to make the joint. Obviously, that is important that they should conform to the relevant standards. Then there's the welding equipment itself. Is it up to standard? Are you following the correct procedures? Are the procedures correct for welding? And then we've got welding personnel, so the people carrying out the welding operation. Have they been trained? Have they been qualified? Do they know what they're doing? And then we've got mechanical testing. So in order to assess whether the joint is of good quality, there are a whole range of mechanical tests you can perform. Are you using the most appropriate tests for that particular joint? Then we move on to inspection. So inspecting the joints in order to determine whether there are any imperfections in the joint. Is that being carried out correctly? And then finally, the standards associated with each of these factors. So there's quite a range of, factors which will affect the integrity of welded PE pipe joints. And I'm going to describe some examples of work we've been doing in each of these six areas. So if we start with pipes and fittings, we have carried out a research project looking at the effects of poor mixing during the extrusion of PE pipes and what effect that has on the integrity of butt fusion joints. So if you are making black polyethylene pipe using carbon black masterbatch, a natural resin, using the inline compounding process where you take masterbatch pellets and natural polyethylene pellets and then dry mix them before putting them directly into the extruder. If that is not done correctly, you can end up having what's called windows in your pipe. And you can see on the image here, the windows are the white areas. So these are areas where there's no carbon black at all. So there's only natural polyethylene resin in those areas. And that can be seen by taking sections from the end of the pipe. So the project that that we did was, first of all, to quantify the degree of windows in any pipe using image analysis techniques, and then to determine what level of windows actually has no detrimental effect on the performance of the butt fusion joints made using those pipes. So you can see examples here where we have a reduced section tensile test specimen from a joint without windows. We've got high ductility in the joint, which is what you would expect from a good quality weld. If you have high levels of windows in your pipe, then you will end up with a brittle fracture, as you can see in the right-hand image. So in terms of quantification of windows, we developed a procedure where, first of all, we cut a ribbon from the end of the pipe, around 250 microns in thickness. The reason why that was chosen was because that you can create this thickness simply by using the trimming tool of a butt fusion machine. So you don't have to have fancy microtomying equipment. You can do it using a butt fusion machine. And the important thing is that the length of the ribbon must be greater than the circumference of the pipe, so that you are looking around the whole pipe circumference. And then a square section is then cut from that ribbon in the area where, by eye, you can see the highest level of windows. And then that section is then photographed. And then a 10 by 10 square containing the highest level of windows in that photograph is then cropped for analysis. So that is a grayscale image, and we convert that to a black and white image using a grayscale threshold of 60. So we found that gave the most consistent results. So that means that if a pixel can be anywhere between 0, which is completely black, to 255, which is completely white, and a grayscale threshold of 60 means that any gray that is less than 60 will be classed as black, and any pixel with a gray greater than 60 will be classed as white. So that then gives us our black and white image, and then we can simply count the number of white pixels in that image and compare it with the total number of pixels to give our percentage of windows in that particular pipe. So after doing that, we then need to determine what the critical level is. So what we did is we made a large number of butt fusion welds in pipes with different degrees of windows, and mechanically tested the butt fusion joints according to the European standard 12814 part 7, which uses a reduced section specimen. And then we measured the average energy to break per unit cross-sectional area and drew a graph of that against the log of the average percentage windows in that joint. And we can draw a line, as you can see here. And then we looked at those specimens that failed in a brittle manner, and also the specimens that failed in a ductile manner. Now, what the standards require is that there should be no brittle failures. So we have taken this value, which is 427 kilojoules per meter squared, where you can see above that value, there are no brittle failures. And then that relates to a percentage of 0.5 windows. So to ensure that all the failures are ductile, then the percentage windows value should be less than 0.5. So this work was presented at Plastic Parts 20 in Amsterdam. Unfortunately, I couldn't attend because of COVID. So the plan is that I will be presenting this at the spin-off conference in Johannesburg in September this year. So moving on to the next factor, which is welding equipment and procedures, and in this case, specifically looking at butt fusion welding procedures. Some of you may know that there is an ISO standard 21307, which specifies butt fusion joining procedures for polyethylene pipes. And this standard says that you can use a single low pressure procedure where the bead up pressure and the fusion pressure is 0.17 megapascals. That's the interface pressure. Or you can use a dual pressure, a dual low pressure procedure, where after 10 seconds of fusion, the interface pressure is reduced from 0.17 to 0.025 megapascals. Or you can use a single high pressure procedure where you are increasing the pressures by a factor of about 3. So this is all on the same material, and there are 3 different procedures that are allowed. So we carried out some work to compare the short-term and long-term properties of fusion welds in polyethylene pipe made according to different procedures, including the UK water industry specification procedure, WIS 43208, the German DVS procedure 2207 part 1, and the American ASTM F2620, as well as some other more non-standard procedures. And we also looked at correlating the size and geometry and structure of the weld and the weld beads with the mechanical properties of the joints produced. So we were looking at geometric factors of the bead, including the root length, the central notch height, the bead height, and the bead width. And we also looked at the microstructure and also the micromechanical properties of the welded joints. And the results of this showed that all of the welds that were made to different welding procedures achieved the requirements of the short-term tensile test. So this was the tests that we used were reduced section tensile test, tensile impact test, and also guided side bend test. We also looked at the long-term performance of the welds using a constant load elevated temperature test, which I will describe later. And that showed that the welds made to WIS 43208 and DVS 2207 part 1 had significantly longer times to failure than those made according to ASTM F2620. And it also suggested that the performance, the long-term performance, was related to the weld bead size and shape. And in particular, the root length, not the intrinsic resistance to slow crack growth of the weld interface, because the failure did not occur at the weld interface. Failures occurred at the notch between the weld bead and the pipe surface. We also looked at the effect of welding procedure on the micromechanical properties and also on the melt zone widths. And you can see here in this picture, the red image is an optical micrograph of of the melt zone in the buck fusion weld. And you can see that we can determine the width of the melt zone in the center of the weld. And this is affected greatly by the welding procedure that that you use. And we also use nano indentation to measure the hardness and the elastic modulus. As you go through the welding, you can see the images here, the hardness in white, elastic modulus in gray. And this is on the same scale. This is in hundreds of microns. And you can see very clearly that you get maximum hardness and elastic modulus at the edge of the melt zone, and then it decreases as you go into the melt zone towards the interface. But you can also see that there is an increase in elastic modulus and hardness from the parent pipe value, which is this dotted line, up until the edge of the melt zone. And that allows us to determine a width of the heat affected zone, which is shown by this yellow line here. So you cannot see the heat affected zone optically, but we can determine what it is by using nano indentation measurements. And this value also changes significantly depending on the welding procedure used.
So if we move on to
welding personnel. So when you're welding plastic pipes, the quality of the joint is going to be dependent on the skill of the person carrying out the joint. So training that person will teach them best practice and should provide them a theoretical understanding of the welding process, whether it be about fusion or electrofusion. And certification then also provides that individual with they can show their competency to customers, regulators, and insurance companies. And TWI offers training and certification in PE pipe welding from all abilities, so from new starters to people who've been doing it for many years. And we can carry out this training at one of our training centres, or we can go to the customer's premises, and we can do that and have done that at many locations around the world. So we offer certification to the CSWIP scheme, which is the leading certification scheme in welding and inspection. It's UCAS accredited, internationally recognised, and there are over 40,000 individuals with a CSWIP certificate. So regarding plastic pipe welders, the certification is carried out in accordance with the European standard 13067. And there are a number of categories that you can be certified in. So for butt fusion welding of polyethylene pipes, there's two categories, greater than 315 or less than or equal to 315 millimeters. Same for electrofusion welding, but also saddle welding, and also socket fusion welding. And certification requires both a theoretical and a practical test. So for the practical test, this involves welding a standard test piece, which depends on the category chosen. The joint is then visually inspected by the examiner and is then mechanically tested. So for butt fusion, it's mechanically tested using a reduced section tensile test. And for electrofusion, using a peel decohesion test in accordance with the European standard. The theoretical test consists of a minimum of 20 multiple choice questions, and that depends on the number of welding processes being examined. And some of the subject areas are shown here. So how do you correctly prepare the pipes before welding? How do you weld on site? How do you operate and monitor the equipment being used? How do you prevent faults in the welds? What are the different types of welding procedure? What are the types of imperfections that you may get? And also health and safety aspects. So moving on to mechanical testing. As I mentioned, we did some long-term testing using a constant axial stress test. This is the whole pipe tensile crude rupture test. Now in all of the main standards for qualifying joints, it specifies an elevated temperature hydrostatic pressure test. But unfortunately, because the stress in the hook direction is twice the stress in the axial direction, It means that unless the long-term strength of the weld is less than 50% of that of the parent pipe, then you will get failure in the parent pipe, and you will get no information about the slow crack growth resistance of the butt fusion weld itself. So we have developed a new test which does generate consistently slow crack growth at the welded joint. The way it works is you take a length of pipe with a butt fusion weld in the middle, attach end fittings, the top end fitting has a hole in which allows a push rod to go inside the pipe. The whole lot is then immersed in water at 80 degrees C, which is the standard test temperature for accelerating long-term testing. And then we use a hydraulic jack to apply a tensile stress to the pipe and therefore to the butt fusion weld. This is a photograph of one of the test tanks we have, and you can see there are a number of jointed samples being tested. So this shows a typical failure. This is a butt fusion joint which has been externally debeaded, contains no flaws, and you can see very clearly there are three areas here where there have been cracks going through the wall. Once a crack has gone through the wall, then the effective stress in the rest of the joint obviously increases, which means that eventually you will get a ductile failure, as you can see here. But the key is the time to generate these brittle cracks. If we look at one of these, we can see that we have an area of microductility, which is what you get in slow crack growth. And looking at that in more detail, you can see these ripples emanating from a point source, which is the initiation point of the crack. And these ripples are indicative of slow crack growth. And we are getting this at the interface of the weld. And we've also deliberately put flaws into the joint. As you can see here, we have put an 8mm planar disc, and obviously that has generated failure prematurely at that position. Here's a 4mm one and a 2mm. So we can look at the effect of different sizes of flaws on the integrity of butt fusion joints. And there's not another test that will allow us to do this. We can also put in particulate contamination. So this shows a light loading of talc. So this is approximately 7% by area of talc. And you can see, again, we have an interface failure. Put in more talc and we get a very brittle fracture surface. And if we look at the times to failure with our whole pipe tensile creep rupture test, so if we look at the bottom with no particulates in, we get a time to failure of over 1400 hours. We put in a small amount of particulates and that decreases dramatically to under 8 hours. Put in a heavier amount of talc, and that decreases the failure time to around 5 minutes. So we're going from 1400 hours to 5 minutes with putting different amounts of fine particulates. And we can also determine a long-term tensile welding factor. So as I said, with the hydrostatic pressure test, you will not get failure in the joint unless the long-term tensile welding factor is less than 0.5. So if we took any of these and we would do a hydrostatic pressure test, then the failure would occur in the pipe, and according to that test, there will be nothing wrong with the joint. But if you apply any bending to that joint or any additional axial loads to that joint, then it would snap in two. We have also carried out research into comparing different mechanical test methods for butt fusion joints and polyethylene pipes. So the particular methods we've looked at are different bend tests, three-point bend test, guided side bend test, tensile tests, a dumbbell specimen and a reduced section specimen, high-speed tensile impact test, also coupon creep rupture test. So this is a long-term coupon test, elevated temperature hydrostatic pressure test, and the whole pipe tensile creep rupture test. So we made a number of joints of different qualities in P100 pipe with a thickness of 20 millimeters. And we found that the most discriminating tests were, as we might expect, the short-term test. The most discriminating is the reduced section tensile test. And in the long term, it's the whole pipe tensile creep rupture test. And we also found there was no correlation between short-term tests and long-term tests. So if you want to know the long-term performance of a joint, you have to do accelerated long-term tests. You will not get that from a short-term test. So moving on to inspection. TWI has spent the last 35 years working on non-destructive testing of PE pipe joints, longer than any other organization in the world. From 85 to 95, we did a number of what's called core research program projects. These are funded by member companies of TWI. And this was looking at developing ultrasonic and also radiographic NDT on butt fusion welds in polyethylene pipes. So from 1998 up until now, we've been involved and run a number of European collaborative projects. So the first one was called WINDEP, which ran from 1998 to 2001, had a budget of just over €1 million. And this was to develop conventional ultrasonics, but for only small diameter butt fusion joints, up to 125 millimeters. Then we had another project which ran from 2004 to 2006 called Polytech Systems, slightly larger budget, 1.8 million. And this was to investigate phased array ultrasonics, again for small diameters, but in this case, electrofusion joints. So phased array ultrasonics is the industrial equivalent to the baby scanner. And then from 2010 to 2013, we ran what was called the TESPET project. This had a much bigger budget of €3.5 million. And this was to develop phased array ultrasonics for both butt fusion and electrofusion joints in a wide range of pipe sizes up to 710 millimeters. And then the last European funded project that we ran was from 2016 to 2019 called Polytest. That had a budget of €2.3 million. And this was involved in sizing flaws and also setting up a certification scheme for phased array ultrasonic testing of butt fusion and electrofusion joints in polyethylene pipes, and resulted in the Polytest system. And this is what the Polytest system looks like. This is a photograph of it inspecting a butt fusion joint. And it consists of a probe wedge assembly. So this is what transmits the ultrasound and also receives the reflected signal back. That is attached to a carriage, which also contains an encoder so that we can tell the precise position around the circumference of the joint. And this is held onto the pipe using a series of chain links. And then for inspecting electrofusion joints, we're using basically the same system, but just replacing the probe wedge assembly. So the system itself can be operated in the field, in a trench, over a wide temperature range from 0 to around 50 degrees C. The inspection is performed after the cooling period of the welding cycle. And the system can also be used on pipes that are in service. It's fairly easy and quick to set up. Calibration is required every morning, which normally takes up to about half an hour. And then the calibration is checked every 4 hours, or if there is a large increase or decrease in temperature. And this is normal ultrasonic NDT practice. And in terms of reporting, there's a report performed on each joint, which if there are any indications in the joint, the report will give the location, the size and the character of the indications, and will recommend whether the joint is acceptable or not based on agreed acceptance levels. And the detection error for this system has been shown to be very low. So this shows a schematic of the equipment on a butt fusion joint. So we can see here, this is the probe, and it is attached to a angled wedge so that it is steering the ultrasound towards the butt fusion joint. So the interface is where we are going to see any imperfection. So we've got to get the ultrasound to that interface. And we do that by initially passing the ultrasound through water. So this blue area here is water. It is held in with a conformable membrane. The reason we're using water is that we want to be able to diffract that ultrasound towards the butt fusion joint and not away from the butt fusion joint. So we have to use something with a refractive index less than that of polyethylene. And then because it's phased array ultrasonics, we can electronically scan that beam so that it is covering the whole of the butt fusion joint, all of the wall thickness. And you can see this is the a typical image that you would get from that joint. So you can see, first of all, that we are seeing a reflection here from the internal weld bead. But what we are looking for is any reflections along this green line, which is at the weld interface. And you can see there is an indication just here in suggesting that there is something in the joint that shouldn't be in the joint. So the system takes a cross-sectional image like this every 1 millimeter around the circumference. So this probe is manually moved around the circumference of the joint. And as I say, every 1 millimeter, it will take a cross-sectional image and build up a three-dimensional image of the whole of the joint. And that then allows us to use software to determine the size of any indications in the joint. So we can determine the through thickness, size and position by looking at this cross-sectional image. So we can determine the thickness of the joint, and also the size of the image. We get diffracted signals from the top and the bottom of any flaw, and so we can determine the through thickness size and also the through thickness position. This image in the top left is the raw data. So that is the reflected ultrasonic signal from this black line here. So the cross-sectional image is made up of hundreds of these A-scan images, and that creates this one cross-sectional image. And then we have hundreds of those cross-sectional images around the circumference to give us a full 3D matrix, which means that we can look in other directions. So if we look from the top, then we can also determine the circumferential position and circumferential dimensions of any flaw in the joint. For ultrasonic inspection, we have a different type of phased array probe assembly. So in this case, any flaws are going to be at the interface between the pipe and the fitting. Again, we have a water wedge here. And we are using a certain number of elements within our probe to focus the ultrasound at the interface between the pipe and the fitting. And then we can electronically scan that ultrasound across the whole of the interface. And you can see this is the image that is produced, where you can see here, this is the internal cold zone where there is a reflection because there's no weld here. This is the external cold zone. And then you have indications from each turn of the heating wire. So what we're looking for are any indications underneath the indications from the heating wire. And you can see here that we are inspecting one side of the electrofusion fitting. So we will go as for the butt fusion, every 1 millimeter around the circumference, we will take another cross-sectional image to build up a full three-dimensional image, and then move over to the other side of the electrofusion fitting and do the same on the other side. And in the same way, we can determine the position and size of any flaws. So in this case, in the top left hand, we can see the cross-sectional image. So we can see the size of the fusion zone and also the axial dimension of a flaw in that fusion zone, which in this case is a circular disc. And then if we look at from above, then we get this view here, which is called a C-scan image. And here we can see the shape of the disc. We can determine its axial dimension and also its circumferential direction. And then if we look from this direction here, we can get this B-scan image, which again gives us our circumferential dimension and position of any flaw in the joint. And again, this is our original A-scan image. So this is the reflections along this black line here, so that we can see this is the reflection from the flaw, which is very big. And then we've got a reflection from the inside of the pipe here. And so this image is made up of hundreds of these images. And then the full three-dimensional is made up of hundreds of these images. And with this system, we've carried out a whole range of site inspections. This shows one from Rotherham in the UK, where we inspected PE pipe work for cooling water system for nuclear power station. This was in 400 and 560 millimeter butt fusion joints, where they were welding flanges onto the ends of pipes. This is North Wales in the UK. This was a pipeline for a hydroelectric power station, inspecting electrofusion welds in 710 millimeter polyethylene pipes. In the South Pacific, this was for a marine outfall pipeline and butt fusion joints in 800 millimeter pipe. And in Israel, again, butt fusion joints, this was sewage collection in 900 millimeter diameter pipe. So going back to the work we did in Rotherham, EDF Energy requires that all polyethylene pipe work for essential surface water applications have to be inspected using phased array ultrasonics prior to installation. And normally, because this pipe work is welded in the factory, then the welds are almost always perfect. But on one occasion, we did see this very clear indication very close to the top surface. What you may notice is that there's no indication here, which is from the internal weld bead. The reason for that is that in these joints, the internal weld bead was removed prior to inspection. But we could tell the location and size, both through thickness and circumferentially, of this flaw. And because EDF Energy, their requirement is that if anything, any indications are seen, then that joint must be cut out and replaced. They cut that joint out, and then they put it in a butt fusion welding machine and trimmed the joint right through the weld interface until they could see what that indication referred to. And you can see here, this is a photograph of one of the trimmings at the fusion interface. And you can see there is an indication very close to the top surface in the precise location that the phased array said it would be. And it turns out that this was actually a fleck of paint. When they were doing the butt fusion welding, at the same time as they were taking the heater plate out, there was an overhead crane going over the welding machine, and a fleck of paint from the crane landed in the joint and got encapsulated in the joint. This is more site inspections from, this is from Milan in this case. Polyethylene pipeline for gas. We looked at butt fusion joints, and we also looked at electrofusion joints. This shows an image from an electrofusion joint. So we're looking, in this case, we're looking down onto the joint. So looking in this sort of area here, and you can see we've got indications from the heating wires, but we've also got these indications, which is clearly showing something up that shouldn't be there. So this joint was cut out and pulled apart, and you can see very clearly that these indications relate to voids at the interface. And in this case, it appears that the reason why this happened was that after the pipe was scraped, it was accidentally dropped onto the bottom of the trench and not cleaned before it was inserted into the electrofusion fitting. So there was water on the bottom of the pipe, which during the welding evaporated and caused these voids. So we can detect flaws, but NDT is not going to be of much use unless you know whether that flaw is acceptable or not. So flaw acceptance criteria is very important. So this is the minimum size of flaw or minimum concentration of particulate contamination that reduces the short-term or long-term integrity of the joint. So if we look at short-term integrity and start with electrofusion, in the ISO standards 4427 part 3 or 4437 part 3, this states that brittle failure in a peel decohesion test must be less than a third of the fusion zone length. So we can actually use this as an acceptance criteria for NDT. So the total length of lack of fusion indications at any circumferential position must be less than a third of the fusion zone length. And because we can measure the length of the indications and we can measure the length of the fusion zone, we can use this as an acceptance criteria. For pot fusion, the ISO standards state that only ductile failures are acceptable when tested to ISO 13953, which is a reduced section tensile test. And we can again use this as an acceptance criteria for NDT, that any flaws that result in a non-ductile failure when tested to ISO 13953 are unacceptable. But this needs to be determined experimentally. And we've spent many years correlating what we see with the NDT with the results of reduced section tensile tests. So we do have a lot of this information. In terms of long-term integrity, for electrofusion joints, if a joint contains no flaws in the whole pipe tensile crude rupture test, we will get failure in the pipe from the notch due to the external cold zone. If we have critical flaws, then the pipe will shear out of the fitting. In butt fusion, if there are no flaws and the weld beads are left on, then you will generate slow crack growth at the notch between the weld bead and the pipe. If you do have critical flaws, then failure will occur through the weld interface. So we can use this as a long-term acceptance criteria for NDT. So the minimum size or flaw or concentration of particulate contamination that causes failure to propagate through the weld interface is then unacceptable. And again, this needs to be determined experimentally. So the way we determine this experimentally is, first of all, we've developed procedures for consistently applying, including flaws, into both butt fusion and electrofusion joints. These procedures are now in ISO technical specification 16943 and 22499. And then once we have put a known amount of flaw into the joint, we then carry out whole pipe tensile crude rupture testing. And we then need to quantify the amount of particulate contamination. We do this using X-ray microtomography combined with image analysis. So X-ray tomography requires an X-ray source and a detector. So the detector consists of a scintillator screen, which converts X-rays to optical light that then goes through a set of optics and is then detected by a CCD camera. So a pot fusion specimen is then inserted into the equipment. So this is a small section of a pot fusion joint, full thickness. The X-rays are applied and an image is captured by the CCD camera. And then the image is rotated a degree or less at a time and creates a large number of images that can then be combined to create a three-dimensional X-ray image of that part, which then allows us to take a virtual section at the interface of that part and then use image analysis to quantify the amount of particulates at the interface. Regarding visual inspection, we have very recently set up a new C-SWIP scheme for plastic pipe welding inspectors. This consists of a 3-day training course. It was launched just before the pandemic, which was not very good timing. And it covers the theory of plastic welding, health and safety, weld imperfections, materials QA, practical visual inspection, and comparison then with floor acceptance criteria. And then finally, we look at standards on PE pipe. And TWI has been active in developing standards on PE pipe and PE pipe welding for over 25 years. So I am the UK principal expert in ISO TC138 SC5 Working Group 17, which is looking at alternative test methods for pipes. And in this working group, we have published two standards on face array ultrasonic inspection, one on electrofusion joints and one on butt fusion joints. And TWI provided the base documents for both of these technical specifications. We're currently developing a standard on inspection of butt fusion joints using time of flight diffraction, which is another ultrasonic technique. Another ISO working group, 138 SC5 working group 5, and that is currently revising the ISO standard 18553, which is methods for assessing pigment or carbon black dispersion in polyolefin pipes, fittings, and compounds. In Europe, I'm the UK principal expert in TC249 Working Group 16, which has published a lot of standards on mechanical testing of joints in polyethylene pipes, on qualification of plastics welding personnel, on non-destructive testing of joints in plastics, on imperfections, and also a couple of standards on one related to tasks and responsibilities of plastic welding supervisors and one on specification of plastics welding procedures. And then in the US, I'm a member of ASTM subcommittee E706, which has developed standards on, again, NDT of PE pipe joints. Also subcommittee 1720, which is revising standards on electrofusion fittings, electrofusion welding, butt fusion welding pipes, and F1740 on various testing techniques for joints in polyethylene pipes. I'm also a member of AWS committee B2FG1A, which has published standards on welding procedure and performance qualification of plastics welding inspectors, and also evaluation of thermoplastic welds. And then finally, ASME, a member of a number of working groups that have developed the ASME boiling pressure vessel code, section 3, mandatory appendix 26, which is on rules for construction of class 3 buried polyethylene piping. Okay, thank you. I hope that was of interest. And I am ready to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Mike. That was really good. Just to let you know, you have got a number of questions. I'm not sure in the time left you'll be able to answer all of them. But shall I just go from the top?
Yeah.
Okay. So the first one is, can you quantify the likelihood of brittle failure on the scale after 0.05% window and higher?
Can you just repeat that?
Yeah. Can you quantify the likelihood of brittle failure on the scale after 0.05% window and higher?
I don't think we can. We've done enough work to estimate the chance of brittle failure. What we wanted to do was ensure that if you go below that value, you should not get any brittle failures. So you may not get brittle failures if it's 0.6 or 0.7, but you may do. So to be on the safe side, that's why we've chosen 0.5.
Okay. Is the whole pipe tensile creep rupture test a standardised method, ISO or BS?
Yes, it's BSEN 12814 part 3, and it's, I think, appendix B in that standard.
Okay. What is the difference between bristle on ductile failure?
So ductile failure is where you have a lot of yielding in the joint. So you have a lot of energy expended in breaking that joint. And that is, in ISO, this is what you have to have to qualify either a butt fusion or an electrofusion joint. If you've got brittle failure, you've got very little energy. As soon as you, if you look at a stress strain curve, then the stress will go up and then it will immediately go down. There will be no extra energy exerted after you've got failure. And that is not acceptable in ISO.
Right. What is stress induced in the wall during the whole pipe tensile creep rupture test?
It is a pure axial stress. So we have no internal pressure. We are just applying an axial stress to ensure that we always generate failure at the joint.
Right. Do you have to use specialised PAUT equipment or can you use any phased array unit?
The control unit is off the shelf. The probe has to be made specially. The wedge has to be made specially. If you use a probe wedge assembly that you would use for metals, then it's not going to give you anything in polyethylene. But you can program the flaw detector to operate with polyethylene. So we do have a training course for phased array ultrasonic inspection of butt fusion joints and electrofusion joints in polyethylene pipes. Although at the moment we are only offering that to companies that we will form a partnership with so that they can use that equipment only once their operators have been trained and qualified by us.
Okay. The photograph of slow crack growth in the butt fusion creep test showed features that a forensic metallurgist would recognize as fatigue striations. What gives rise to the ripples under slow crack growth conditions?
It's the way the crack moves. So rather than growing constantly, it has a slip stick. So it will grow very fast and then it will stick at that location for a period of time before it grows again, which does give you something that looks very much like a fatigue crack in metals, but it's not.
Thank you. Do you just want to do a couple more? And then obviously the ones that are all outstanding, I can send over to you so you can follow up, because there are quite a few.
Okay, yeah.
We've got like 23 more questions.
Oh, right.
So unless people want to be here all night. The next one is, are there any tests done to measure the static current produced during the gas flow through pipes?
I believe we have done some research. It's not something that I've been involved in, but I have heard of one of my colleagues looking at that issue. It was a confidential piece of work, so it's not something that I can give any results for, but we have done some work in that area.
Okay. What are the weld defects in PE?
Come on the course. Come on the inspector course and we'll tell you. There is a whole range of defects, and each one of those is described, and we've got samples of every type of defect that you can get. But there are too many to go through at this moment.
Okay, well, obviously when we send out the presentation, they've got your details as well, so yep, people can contact you that way if they want to join any courses. Just a couple of more. What criteria can one use to determine if too much hydrocarbon liquids has permeated into the PE pipe to allow a proper butt fusion joint, either repair or reuse of pipe?
Well, if there's too much gone into the pipe, then you are not going to get a very good performing joint. But in terms of quantifying that, we do a lot of research into permeation of hydrocarbons into polyethylene. So that is something that we can do by assessing the amount of hydrocarbons in that polyethylene against the mechanical testing of the butt fusion joint. But that's not something that we have done. It's something we can do.
Okay. I'm aware we're running over a little bit. So last one is, how does hydrocarbon permeation affect the life of existing butt fusion joints?
I would like to know. Yeah, not something that we've done, but I think it is important to the oil and gas industry. And I would like to do that.
Okay. I'm aware that people are sort of dropping off and we've run over. So as I said, is it okay if we, if you can contact the people with the outstanding questions?
Yeah, brilliant. That's fine. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much, everybody, for attending. And thank you very much, Mike, for a really good presentation. And as I said, we will be sending out a link to the recording and also the presentation in the next couple of days. And that will include Mike's contact details. So thank you very much, everybody, for attending.
Thank you.